Well, nobody can discredit the impact that people like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks had on slavery and black history. But some of the people that inspire me most are people like the radical abolitionist John Brown, who was a white citizen who could have easily conformed to the ways of the oppressor and really torture slaves like the oppressors did. Instead, John and his sons led an attack during the Bleeding Kansas conflicts that weren't as peaceful as they probably could have been, and some of his methods weren't peaceful like they should have been, but he justified his actions by saying they were the will of God. What John did know was that everyone deserved to have equal rights and an equal chance at life. And so after his attacks in the Bleeding Kansas conflict, he gained some popularity, in which he was able to amass an army of about 21 people who then broke into an arsenal to gather weapons to arm slaves in their rebellion against slavery. John was actually caught, he and his people, during that break-in of the arsenal and later hanged, but not before he became an icon in American history.
When I think about Black History Month, the first thing that comes to my mind is Harriet Tubman. She was an abolitionist, a humanitarian, a spy for the Union with the Civil War, and also a devout Christian. Harriet Tubman was a slave, of course, and early in her life, she suffered a severe head injury at the hand of her master from being beaten. As a result of this tragedy, Harriet Tubman began to have dreams and visions about what it would be like to become free. Eventually, she acted upon those dreams, and she escaped from Maryland and went to Philadelphia. She later returned to Maryland several times to help save her family, and then began to go further south to save other slaves as well. A few years ago, my husband and I went to Savannah, Georgia, and we went on a Black History tour. While we were there, we went to the oldest African American church in the United States, and it was founded in 1773. While we were there, we learned that this church played a role in the Underground Railroad. It was known as a safe place for them to go. They had holes in the floor, which was in a diamond pattern, and those holes helped the slaves to breathe while they were underground. This diamond pattern was also significant because it was located on several historical homes during the tour. The other thing that we learned was that the slaves also used quilts to help give messages to one another and maybe to tell them which direction they needed to go. What I love most about Harriet Tubman is her strength, courage, and determination. I can only imagine what Harriet Tubman must have felt like to be free as a slave, but also to be free in Christ.
Well, whether you're a baseball fan or not, you've probably heard of the name Jackie Robinson, and for good reason. Jack Roosevelt, or Jackie Robinson, was the first African American to play Major League Baseball in the modern era. Robinson broke the baseball color line when the Brooklyn Dodgers started him at first base on April 15, 1947. As the first team to play a black man since the 1880s, the Dodgers ended racial segregation that had relegated black players to the Negro Leagues for six decades. The example of Robinson's character and exceptional talent challenged the traditional basis of segregation, which then marked many other aspects of American life and contributed significantly to the civil rights movement. In addition to his cultural impact, Robinson also had an exceptional baseball career. In over 10 seasons, he played in six World Series and contributed to the Dodgers' 1955 World Championship. He was Rookie of the Year in 1947. He was selected to six consecutive All-Star games. He was voted the National League Most Valuable Player in 1949, and he was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1962. In 1997, Major League Baseball universally retired his uniform number 42 across all Major League teams, which meant that no player on any team could ever again wear the number 42, with one exception. And that began in 2004 when Major League Baseball adopted a new annual tradition called Jackie Robinson Day, which stated that every player on every team on that day would wear the number 42. Robinson was also known for his pursuits outside the baseball diamond. He was the first black TV analyst in Major League Baseball. He was the first black vice president of a major American corporation. And he helped establish the Freedom National Bank, an African-American national financial institution based in Harlem. In recognition of his achievements both on and off the field, Robinson was posthumously awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom and the Congressional Gold Medal. Jackie Robinson, a man worth remembering and a life of impact worth celebrating.
The black history icon that inspired me would have to be the strong, amazing Rosa Parks. She was a role model for courage in the face of racial injustice. She was willing to sacrifice everything for what she felt was right. By refusing to give up her seat on a Montgomery, Alabama city bus in 1955, black advocate Rosa Parks helped initiate the civil rights movement in the United States. The leaders of the local black community organized a bus boycott that began the day Miss Rosa Parks was convicted of violating the segregation laws. Led by the young Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the boycott lasted more than a year. The boycott ended in 1956 with a 9-0 vote when the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that the bus segregation was unconstitutional. Over the next half century, Parks became a nationally recognized symbol of dignity and strength in the struggle to end entrenched racial segregation. Had she not only sat firm in her seat, but also in her beliefs of what she felt was right and wrong, we would live in a different world and a different nation. I do the very best I can to look upon life with optimism and hope, and looking forward to a better day. But I don't think there is anything such as complete happiness. It pains me that there is still racism. I think when you say you're happy, you have everything you need and everything that you want, and nothing more to wish for. I haven't reached that stage yet. Rosa Parks.
I'm Lauren Sikorsky, daughter of Wendy and Daryl Flowers, and today I chose to do my bio on one of the greatest entertainers of all time, Mr. Sammy Davis Jr. He was best known for his acting, best known for singing with Frank Sinatra, and this is my favorite.
When I first began flying out of Thailand in support of the Vietnam War, Chappie James was legendary. As an experienced colonel, Daniel Chappie James teamed up with another hero, Colonel Robin Olds, a World War II triple ace. Flying the new F-4 in their mid-40s, they were ancient in our flight line world. Both destined to become generals, they formed a legendary team named Black Man and Robin. James flew 78 combat missions into North Vietnam, many in the Hanoi area, and he led a flight in the Operation Bolo MiG sweep in which 7 communist MiG-21s were destroyed, the highest total kill of any mission during the Vietnam War. To us new lieutenants, Chappie was the man to emulate. Chappie James trained the Tuskegee Airmen during World War II, flew combat in the Korean and Vietnam Wars, and in 1977 became the first black military officer to attain the rank of 4-star general. He was put in charge of NORAD, the North American Air Defense Command in Colorado Springs, Colorado. An incident in 1969 significantly boosted his career. He was given command of Huilis Air Force Base in Libya in the wake of the infamous Muammar Gaddafi's coup. This coup brought Gaddafi to power and sent the pro-US king into exile. James personally recalled an incident when Gaddafi attempted to shut down the U.S. base. He recalled, "One day Gaddafi ran a column of half-tracks through my base, right through the housing area at full speed. I shut the barrier down at the gate and met Gaddafi a few yards outside it. He had a fancy gun in a holster and kept his hand on it. I had my .45 in my belt. I told him to move his hand away. If he had pulled that gun, he never would have cleared his holster, and they never sent any more half-tracks." Although his life was cut tragically short at the age of 58 by a heart attack, his career in the Air Force was long and distinguished. In addition to the Distinguished Service Medal, his honors included the Legion of Merit, the Distinguished Flying Cross, a Presidential Unit Citation, and several honorary degrees. Daniel Chappie James blazed a trail of distinction for African Americans in the military and became a role model for us all. He summed up his thoughts on his role as an American serviceman by saying, "I've fought in 3 wars and 3 more wouldn't be too many to defend my country. I love America, and as she has weaknesses or ills, I'll hold her hand."
Thinking about a particular jazz musician that might have influenced me, there were many great players, but something else came to my mind over and above individuals that influenced me was the fact that jazz music and the effect that it had on our nation from its birth down in Congo Square, New Orleans, with people from Africa, from the Caribbean, Creoles, folks from the Delta, little bit of flavor of the church mixed into it. It was America's music. Jazz is America's music. We gave it to the world. And at a certain point in time in our country, in the late 30s and the early 40s, in a segregated, struggling society, I think jazz music was at the right place at the right time to show the majority population that people that they might have thought didn't have any special talents or abilities were masters of something, could create, and were innovators and extremely skilled and talented people. These people were the jazz musicians and the singers of the day, the Billie Holidays, the Lester Youngs, Coleman Hawkins, Teddy Wilson, Lionel Hampton, Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Jimmy Lunsford, Cannonball Adderley, John Coltrane, you could put Miles Davis, and so many other musicians, and they had an opportunity to show their skills and their talents and their abilities to the majority culture. At that time, jazz music was the pop music of its day. The whole society gravitated to that music. It didn't cure all the ills, but I do believe that the artistry and the professionalism of some of the folks at that time showed the majority of folks in the United States that, hey, these folks have some skills, they have talents. Maybe my thinking is not correct about how I'm perceiving these folks. And I think at that point, that music and those artists had an opportunity to really affect and begin to make change in the way that people perceive people. So I think jazz music at that time was in the right place, was the right idiom, and I think it did a big service to our nation.
Many have worked so that the woman's voice could be heard. And as a woman, the first thing that I think is, where would we be if it had not been for such great women as Sojourner Truth? Born Isabel Bomfree in 1843, she said, "The Spirit calls me and I must go," and changed her name to Sojourner Truth. During her life, she was a strong advocate for abolishing slavery, for human and women's rights. She's known for her successful fight in court against her son being sold into slavery, and also famous for the "Ain't I a Woman" speech, which she delivered in 1851 at the first Ohio Women's Rights Convention. Never heard it? Well, here are a couple of excerpts. Imagine 1851 being a Negro woman and saying these things. "Then that man over there says women needs to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches and have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place, and ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it and bear the lash as well. Ain't I a woman? Then that little man in black there, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where'd your Christ come from? Where'd your Christ come from? From God and a woman. Man ain't had nothing to do with them."
If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, then these women here together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up. And now they's asking to do it, the men better let them. Now old Sojourner Truth ain't got nothing more to say. Sojourner Truth, a voice for human and women's rights.
It was 1968-69 school year, and I was a fifth grader. I was going to be bused out to Brentwood Elementary School. That's when the Fort Wayne Community Schools first started busing in Fort Wayne, Indiana, and integration. I was a part of that. Going into that, I was very afraid. My anxiety level was very high just because I was going into new territories. It was a situation where I knew that I was going to be the only black student there. That was very scary. But to my surprise, once I got to Brentwood, there were three of us. And that made me feel better, but it was still high anxiety. But I quickly learned that those students there, they were just like me. I had to adjust to their environment. They had to accept and adjust to what I brought to the table. And through that, it made me understand. It made me realize that I can get along and got along with people regardless to their race, regardless to their color. Through those experiences, I found a person by the name of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was a very big inspiration to me because of what he stood for, because he stood for nonviolence in a time in the United States where integration and accepting others was very difficult. Because of the influence Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. has had on my life, his I Have a Dream speech has meant so much to me. I say to you, my friends, even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain shall be made low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will one day be free. This will be the day that all God's children will be able to sing that new meaning. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, and when we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all God's children,
black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, thank God.